Good morning, everyone, and welcome. We're glad you're here today, those that are here in person, obviously, and those that are watching online. Thank you for sharing in our service today. If you're visiting, thank you for visiting, being a part of our service. Our desire today is to honor God and lead in worship today. So let's continue with this great hymn, At Calvary. Song for you. It's been a while since we've done this song called Answer to Prayer. But this week I had the opportunity to on my way to work in the morning, I listened to Christian radio, and this particular day was on Focus on the Family. They had a gentleman on there named Andrew Brunson, I think his name is, who was a missionary, and his wife missionaries to Turkey. He spent 2 years in prison in Turkey, unjustly persecuted, if you will, for his beliefs. But he was telling his story about how he struggled and his faith was, he was struggling. He was having a very difficult time, could not see his wife, but just every now and then. And, you know, they told the whole story of how it all, how those 2 years went by for them. Well, his wife would tell him that people were praying for him, that she knew that people were praying for him. And of all the stuff that was going on in his life, that brought him a tremendous amount of comfort and peace, knowing that others knew of his plight and that they were praying for him. Eventually, he got out as a result of the U.S. government was able to get in there and get him out. They declared him guilty, but then they let him go free because they were, in his words, they were tired of messing with him. They wanted him gone. They wanted him out of the country. But one of the last things he said as he left the country was, "We love Turkey." There was no bitterness there. He said, "We love Turkey." But I say all of that because this song is about answer to prayer. Today is the day of prayer for the persecuted church. And even though we live in freedom in this country, we don't have that kind of persecution, but it's going on and across the world. So, you know, we can be somebody's answer to prayer. We can pray for the persecuted church. But that's what this song, as well as, you know, the church, but you've got neighbors, you've got friends that need you. We all need each other. So the song's called Answer to Prayer. So many people living down on the time. We'll have our ministry opportunities. I don't know who's doing that today, but it's Mr. Cook. Come on, Jim.
It's my cue, right?
I threw you off.
I didn't get my third song. Hey, what's this? Look what I got, Brill. Look what I got. It's my apron. I'm getting that ready for Saturday. Saturday's our ladies' brunch. What time are they coming?
10:30.
This coming Saturday, be there or be square, you ladies.
That won't be soon enough for me. I have to get my apron on.
The men will be serving the ladies.
And look, I have something smelly in here. It smells really nice. We'll be giving these away.
Is that lavender?
It's a little sachet. Oh.
Janet's allergic to that.
Huh? Janet, are you allergic? Well, look, she's allergic to purple. Lavender. It's time to get to the scripture reading, Pastor. Oh. I gotta be serious. Okay. But it won't be too soon. You know? I did a lot of cooking when I was in Texas, but you know, I haven't worn this in a while. And the deal is the leaders are gonna be wearing black and white, wearing aprons, and we're gonna be serving. That we're looking forward to it. Right, Wally? Yes, we are. I can tell you're so excited. All right. Be there. Our scripture reading. Thank you. You can take me seriously, please. What? I'm getting a signal. He says, take this off. Is that what you said? I'm covering the mic. That'll wait for now. Well, let's be serious. Seriously. We want to celebrate the women. And you guys are special. And you do so much for us. And as men, we don't acknowledge it as much as we should. So hopefully we'll have a good time and show you our appreciation. 1 Peter chapter 1. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again in a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. You are protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, even though now, for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials, that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not see him now, but believe in him, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, obtaining as the outcome of your faith the salvation of your souls. Let's thank God for his word, remembering our gifts and offerings. We thank you, Mountain View, for your generosity and giving and your faithfulness to give to the general fund, to give to missions, our kingdom workers, to benevolence, and to the capital funds. We thank you for that. We lift these up as thanksgiving to God our Father. Let's pray. Father in heaven, you are holy. You are righteous in all your ways. Your word is true. You've revealed yourself, Christ our Lord, Jesus. And we're thankful that as believers, we have been called children of God. And Lord, it's not been revealed what we shall be, but we know that when we see him, we shall be like him. And we take hope in the resurrection, knowing that you are faithful to the end. As you've said in your word, we're confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will continue it till the day of Christ Jesus, perfect it to the day of Christ Jesus. We hope in this word. Father, open our ears to hear and our hearts to understand what you have for us this morning. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Slain, holy, holy is he.
nation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Of thunder, blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, was and is and is to come. Your name is power, strength, and living water, such a marvelous mystery.
As we prepare ourselves for the Word of God, we want to go to the Lord first and ask Him to lead us and guide us, but also we want to pray for our congregation, those of you and those who are watching online. We welcome all of you here today. We know a lot of you have some physical problems, and we want to pray for you. Some struggling perhaps emotionally, and we want to pray for you as well. But let's come together now, and would you just join me in your heart in agreement as we pray. Father, we need you. Without you, we're nothing. We're desperate for you. We pray that you'd be the King of our lives this week. And forgive us for those moments where we perhaps took back the lordship of our own lives. And we ask you, Father, that as we open the Word of God, that you might guide us into your truth, that you might encourage us. That, Lord, we might perhaps, those who are struggling with depression, anger, indifference, that today might be a day of kind of refocusing and readjusting our thinking. And Father, we pray for our congregation, some who are still at home, and we pray, Lord, that you would comfort them during this time. It's a time of great loneliness for many believers, and you need encouragement. May you be with them. And Father, for those in our congregation who struggle physically, who have different physical needs, and I pray, Lord, you would, that you would heal them first. That would be our first prayer. But sometimes, like the Apostle Paul, you give us a thorn in the flesh. And so, Father, if that be the case, may you comfort them. May you strengthen them. Father, may they see a new dimension of your joy and of your peace in the midst of their struggle. But, Lord, we do pray that you would allay the pain and that they experience. You set them free from that, Lord, that they might experience greater joy. And now, Father, again, the Spirit of God, we thank you so much for the Spirit of God. And, Lord, I pray that your Spirit would use your feeble servant to communicate your truth in a way that, Lord, your Spirit can use it to kind of rivet those truths to the walls of our minds. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen. Storm clouds looming. You ever feel like that in your life? Storm clouds are looming. Things are going bad, things are difficult, things are hard. Well, the believers in that Peter wrote at that time, is our series, is storm clouds looming, a verse-by-verse study of 1 Peter. And why did Peter write the believers at that time? Because they were facing persecution. In fact, the greatest persecution had not come, but they still at that moment were facing persecution. Nero had come onto the scene and he was killing Christians and burning them. And then, in fact, he burned down Rome and blamed it all on the Christians. But it really wasn't until about 112 AD that the first kind of a outbreak of persecution, and Pliny, who was the governor of Bithynia, sent a letter to Trajan, who was the emperor of Rome, telling him that he was killing all the Christians, persecuting all the Christians, and executing them, in fact. And Trajan wrote back and said, that's fine, except if they recant their faith and if they will agree to worship the Roman gods, let them live. But it wasn't really until about 249 AD that the persecution or killing of the Christians really on a large scale broke out in the Roman Empire. And yet here we are in 1 Peter chapter 1, and Peter's writing these believers and he's saying to them, you can have joy. Even though he knew that this was in the 60s AD, he knew that there was greater persecution to come. In fact, Peter was not going to live much longer. He was going to be killed. Nonetheless, he writes to them and tells them that, you know, you can have joy as well. And those words that he gives to those believers in Asia Minor are just as applicable to us today. And yet some of you, perhaps, I know as I speak, especially during this difficult time, you're probably asking the question, where's the joy? Where's the happiness? I'm not experiencing that right. And yet, God promises us that. For example, in Psalm 16, verse 11, says, you will make known to me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. In your right hand there are pleasures evermore. In Psalm 26, we read, they drink their fill of the abundance of your house, and you give them to drink of the river of your delights. We probably could translate that Hebrew idea, or at least the word, that last word, the idea of it as you give us rivers of joy. And even Jesus spoke about that. In John 15, we read, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you so that, watch this, my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be made full. J.I. Packard once said, he's a great theologian who's now with the Lord, he said, God values pleasure, both his and ours. It is his pleasure to give us pleasure as a fruit of his saving love. And yet you ask the question, where's the joy? So today, as we open our text, I want us to see what Peter has to say, and because I think Peter really lays it out very clearly as to how a believer can have joy in the midst of despair, in the midst of deep trouble, in the midst of life going south. So let's open our Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 1. And as we get there, we want to go to verse 6, but we'll have to look back just a moment at the previous three verses. But in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 6, it says, in this. Now, we want to stop right there. In this, he says, in this, what's he talking about? Well, he's talking about what he just said in the previous three verses. Remember what he said in verse, and we're not going to get too deep into this, but in verse 3, he said we have a living hope. How do we know we have a living hope? Now, hope in the biblical sense, you know this, hope in the biblical sense is not as the world thinks of hope. The world thinks of hope like wishing on a star. That's not what we're talking about. Hope is not wishing in the Bible. Hope is a fixed confidence that God is true to his promises, and that what he promises in my life and in this world will be carried out. There can be no doubt about that. That's hope. That's a living hope. That's why he says it's living. It's not dead. It's not something that you hoped on, you hoped for, and now it's gone. It's bye. Gone bye-bye. So, secondly, though, he said we have a permanent inheritance, and that inheritance points to something that is to come. An inheritance, he's speaking really of our salvation. All of this, as we saw last week, had to do with Peter saying, look, you have this living hope, this salvation, you have this permanent inheritance, and then he says you have this divine protection. He's talking about, though God protects us, he's talking about our salvation is protected. Nothing can take it away. No one can take it away. I can't take it away from myself. I can't cause myself to lose it. There are those who might say that, but that's not true. Now, the Apostle Peter was saying, in all these things, we have reason to rejoice. We have reason to rejoice because of our inheritance, because of our salvation. Now get this. Essentially what Peter was saying, I think, if I could capture it, is that when we forget about what we have in Christ, our circumstances become the lens through which we see life. When, in other words, when we forget how blessed we are, our circumstances become the lens through which we see life. And would anybody argue with me, debate that when you do that, life becomes, in your view, distorted? That you have a distorted view of life? A right perspective leads to right living. Right thinking leads to right living. And a right perspective leads to joyful living. The Apostle Peter speaks about salvation, which gives us a living hope and reason for rejoicing because it is protected for eternity and it is our permanent inheritance in eternity. Peter's focus is all on salvation. Why? Because he says, just as I've said, he says, because when you get that, when you realize what you have, then that's grounds for joy. In the midst of life's difficulties, in Luke chapter 10, there's the account of Jesus sending out his disciples 70 of them, 2 by 2. And they go out, and he gives them authority. And they come back, and they say, wow, man, that was really cool. Even the demons listened to us and did what we told them. And Jesus says, that's good. Yeah, he says, I've given you authority to over scorpions and snakes. Some of you don't act like we have authority over snakes, right? He says, I've given you authority over scorpions and snakes and over the spirits. He says, don't rejoice over that. Rejoice that your name is written where? Heaven, in heaven. Listen, your life can stink. You may be in a situation where life, everything is going badly. I mean, it can be Charlie Brown on steroids. And yet, if you are saved, if you have trusted Christ, if you have eternal life that he promises you, you are the most fortunate person in the room. You believe that? The Apostle Peter speaks about salvation, which gives us, again, this living hope. That's where he begins. But he doesn't stop there. His goal in this text is to have believers understand joy that should be their constant companion. Now listen, I think we're all here, and I think we all could be honest to say, I don't have joy all the time. I want that. I admit at times I don't have that. When I let my life or the circumstances or the things I want to happen and they're not happening, I allow that circumstance or those circumstances to rob me of joy. You do that as well, right? We've all been there. So he continues on in this passage. He begins with their salvation. Then he says, okay, now let's move on. Let's move to another perspective. And it starts with salvation. That is foundational. And how often we forget just how wonderful and blessed we are. But in the beginning of verse 6, he says, in this ye greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary. Let's just stop right there. So here he begins to answer the question, how can I have joy while suffering? How can I have joy in hardship? How can I have joy when disappointed? And let's, again, in this passage, he really gets into this. He says, first thing, he says, you greatly rejoice. And the first question we ask is, do we really rejoice when we're in hardship? No, the answer is no, most of the time, right? Unless we're thinking in a biblical sense. The word greatly rejoice is a Greek word which is an intense, expressive term that means to be supremely and abundantly happy, joyful. Now, let me make this clear. Joy is happiness on the inside, if I can say that. It doesn't originate from circumstance. Happiness is based upon circumstances. But joy is that which is happiness that originates from the inside by our thinking, by our focus on what God has done for us and who we are in Christ. Jesus used the word alongside, the same word alongside the ordinary word for rejoicing, which is kairo. He used it in Matthew 5, verse 12. It says, rejoice and be exceedingly, that's the word that we're talking about today, exceedingly glad, for your reward is in heaven, for your reward in heaven is great. For in the same way, they persecute the prophets who were before you. He says, your reward in heaven is great. What is the greatest reward we have in heaven? That's what what Peter's talking about. It's our salvation. That one day we're going to be in heaven. More to come on that. So Peter says, rejoice. Rejoice, have this joy in the midst of difficulty. Peter is saying, when you get your perspective right, when you get your focus right, hardship can actually add to your joy. And some people may be saying, well, wait a minute. That's never happened. Look what it says. He says, if necessary, if need be, depending on your translation. That word if, let me just say this. The word if in the English is translated, is a translation of four different Greek words in the New Testament, Greek New Testament. They're called class conditions. One, the first class is if and it's true. The second class is if and it's not true. The third class is maybe it will be, maybe it won't be. And the fourth class is I wish that it would be true, but more than likely it won't be true. This is a first class condition. It is if and it is true. It could be translated since it is necessary for you to be distressed during difficult times. This indicates that there are special times when God knows that we need to go through a test. We need to go through difficulty. We need to go through hardship. I know some people say, well, God just allows it, but he never designs and determines that you should go through hardship. I'm sorry, folks, he does. It's in the scripture. Please note that Peter says these trials are not meant to be easy. They're not meant to be a walk in the park. Look at the word distressed. It refers not only to physical pain, but also to mental anguish, including sadness, sorrow, disappointment. In fact, at the root of that word, predominant is the idea of sadness and sorrow. And sometimes we go through difficulty, and sometimes believers think that, man, you shouldn't have any sadness, shouldn't have any emotion. Sometimes you do. But we have to refocus back on God's truth to deliver us from those points of sadness. Paul, when he talked about, and I say this at every funeral just about, Paul never said we should not grieve. He says we do not grieve as those who have what? Have no hope. And I've seen over the years in my ministry, I've seen the difference. There's a vast difference between those who grieve who have no hope and those who do grieve and have hope. Big difference. Big difference. Now, what kind of trials are we to experience? What's he talking about here? Well, the word various, oculos, means many-colored, variegated. One of my classmates wrote an article on this word, and he says it actually speaks of the idea of polka dots with different shapes and sizes. A trial can be from the death of a loved one to the toilet backing up. It can be a variety of difficult things in our lives. But what's interesting is that Peter, in chapter 4, uses this same word to describe grace, the manifold grace of God. In chapter 4, verse 10, it says, and each one has received a special gift. Employ it in serving one another as good stewards of the, here's the same word again, manifold grace of God. What's that tell us? It tells us that there's no trial, there's no difficulty, that no circumstance in life that can take us beyond the shadow of God's grace. That God matches his grace to our trials, to our difficulty. Now, the phrase for a little while, that has something to say too. That tells us that trials are not forever. They're simply for a season. When God permits or determines for his child to go through the furnace, he keeps his eye on the clock and his hand on the thermostat. Now, if we don't submit and we don't listen, if we don't hear what he has to say, sometimes he'll reset the clock, or sometimes he'll turn up the thermostat. When I was in college, I was a presser and a dry cleaners, and they stuck me in this back room where I had the, you know, the steam is hot. But I had this big thing that would come down, and once it came down, I would hit two levers. One would put the pressure, and the other would put the steam. And sometimes it would come down, I'd look at the garment, whatever it is, and the wrinkles are not out of it. And so what do? I have to put more steam and more pressure. Sometimes God has to, you're ready to run, aren't you? Sometimes God has to turn up the steam. I'm one he's done that often with. But listen, he will not allow us, and what this says is he will not allow us to remain 1 minute longer. 1 Corinthians 10:13 speaks to that. No temptation has overtaken you but such as is common to man, and God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond, or tested, that word can be translated in the Greek, tested as well, beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will provide the way of escape so that you will be able to endure. Peter is essentially saying God is watching over you during your hardship. You may not feel like it during your persecution to the believers there. He says you may not feel like it. It may not look like it, but God is watching over you. That's the point. Now, why does he design or at least allow hardship, persecution to believers? Well, this speaks to the heart of the number one point here. He says we can have joy while suffering, knowing of God's promised work. And you can add this to this, God's promised work in your life, in my life. My wife was telling me about somebody who just had back surgery, and she said she's in a lot of pain. And that seems to be kind of the case. Some of you have had back surgery, and it seems like when you go through back surgery, the pain is excruciating. And you ask, why would someone want to go through that kind of pain? And the answer is because they know on the other side, eventually they're going to feel better, right? So imagine you want to have your kitchen redone, renovated. And so you, contact a contractor. He comes in. He shows you pictures of what that kitchen can become. He shows you the wallpaper, the paint, the floor. And by this time, you're excited. You're just excited about what that kitchen is going to look like. So much so that you forget the process. In the process, he tears out the wall. Dust is flying everywhere, noise and so forth. Eventually, you say, I got to move out. I got to go somewhere else. I got to go stay with my daughter or my son or whomever. I was like, I can't put up with this. Now, if you told the contractor, say, look, I want you to renovate my my kitchen, but I don't want you to move anything. I don't want you to change anything. He'd say, well, you don't want your kitchen remodeled, right? See, that's kind of the way it is with us. We want God to do something in our lives. We want him to change our lives. But we say, God, be nice. Could you just not take that part out? And he says, no. No, I got so much more for you. But it's going to be painful in the process. The Apostle Paul in Philippians 1:6 said, for I am confident of this very thing. That's hope. That's biblical hope. I am confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect. The word perfect means to mature, to laios. Will mature, complete, until the day of Christ Jesus. What was Paul saying? Paul is saying, look, God promises the work in your life. Now, there's a condition there that clearly in that text, that you have to be willing to say, God, my life is yours. But he says, he promises to work in your life until you leave this earth, if you're obedient. Well, that's exactly what Peter is saying to the believers here, except in that day, except he's saying, look, you can know this, you can believe what this truth, even during hardship. You say, what is this work that Peter is going to do? It's the proving and approving of our faith. The word proof in verse 7, and it's also over in the latter part of verse 7, actually it's used twice. One time it's proof, it's translated proof. The second time it's translated tested, if you have the New American Standard. Same word, basically. One's a verb, one's a noun, dokimas. Speaks of to test for the purpose of approving or affirming the worth of something. Peter illustrated this proof by referring to a goldsmith. What happens with a goldsmith? A goldsmith would not deliberately waste the precious ore. He would put it into a smelting furnace long enough to remove the cheap impurities. And then once that's done, he would pour out the impurities, and then he would take that piece of metal, whatever it might be, and turn it into a very valuable article. In fact, and Jim alluded to this last week, it has been said that the Eastern goldsmith kept the metal in the furnace until he could see his face reflected in the impurities on the surface of the water there. That's a great biblical analogy, of course. And that is, God puts us in the furnace sometimes, in the crucible, in order that he might bring us to a point where we reflect the image of Christ. What, as Paul said, what God foreknew, he also predestined, that we become formed to the image of Christ. So our Lord keeps us in the furnace so that we would reflect his glory and his beauty. But you see, it's the approval of that faith that's more important than just the process. That's the point here. Imagine for a moment that you, a gold mining company wishes to buy a proposed piece of land of which has been said or has been, people have claimed that it has gold on it. What are they going to do? Well, they're going to take that ore, they're going to take some samples, they're going to take it back to his laboratory. An assayer would do this, and he will test it. And of course, they want to know, not only is it real gold, but is there enough there to merit our purchasing that piece of land? And so you get back his report, and his report is, yes, that's really gold, and there's enough there for you to want to purchase and for you to purchase the piece of land. Well, even though the testing that gold is in, that comes back proves that it really is gold, even though that's important, the pieces that come back are not as valuable as the approving of the gold as a result of the test. And that's what Peter is saying here. It's not just that you go through difficulty. Jesus, God, wants to know whether or not our faith is true. Why? Because he's looking for people who are faithful, who are dependable workers, not necessarily gifted people. Abraham. Did God test Abraham? Sure he did. He said, go put a knife through the heart of your son, the son that you've been waiting for so long. What about Job? Was Job tested? Yes. The principle of God testing is seen throughout Scripture. Exodus, for example, 16, verse 4 says, then the Lord said to Moses, behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a day's portion every day, that I may test them whether or not they will walk in my instruction. Deuteronomy, verse 8 says, "You shall remember all the way in which the Lord your God has led you in the wilderness these 40 years. Watch this. That usually introduces a purpose clause. That he might humble you. You ever felt like God was humbling you? Yeah, I've been there. Testing you, knowing what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not." I've never told this story from the pulpit. I've told it to a lot of the leaders. About 5 or 6 years, I think it was about 7 years after I'd come to Mountain View Church. And those who remember, there was those first 5, 6 years were difficult years. I was contacted by a church in D.C., in that area, Loudoun County, interesting enough. Were interested in talking to me. I flew up on a Monday, and I was warning out. I'd just had it. And I flew out on a Monday, went in and spoke to the elder board, shared my philosophy of ministry, and they said, "Would you just wait out in the car for a few minutes?" I said, "Well, wait a minute. I said, "Can somebody show me how to get back to Dulles Airport?" They said, "Well, just wait out in the car and we'll be with you." I was out in the car for 30 minutes. I thought, man, that's a long time. They came out to the car and they said, "Would you come back in?" Okay. And they said to me, "We want you to come." Big church, nice building. Essentially what God did is he said, "Byron, don't run. You're running. The reason you want to leave is because you're running." He said, "This is for you right here." And that's where there was a brokenness in my life. We chiseled away at pride. You see, in my first two churches, they went so well. I thought, you know, when Mountain View got a hold of me, they'd gone through a division, conflict, and so forth. I thought, well, I'll just go down and do my thing, and we'll be fine. No. God said, I want to break you of your pride. The apostle discussion on proven faith in this part of verse 7 actually leads to his main point in the latter part of that. So what's number 2? How can I have joy while suffering, knowing of God's promised honor? Look at verse 7 again. "So that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold, which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ." What did he say? Might be found to be to result in praise and glory and honor. Now, some commentators say, well, that's talking about praise and honor and glory to God. Now, we're going to give God, and we are called to give God praise and glory and honor. But that's not what the passage is saying. The passage here is saying that the believer, there's a point in time when the believer will have the honor and glory and praise of God. That is, if his life is well lived. In Matthew 25, go with me back to Matthew. Hold your place here, obviously. Go back to Matthew 25. In Matthew 25, I've preached on this not long ago, in fact. Matthew 24 and 25 are basically what is called the Olivet Discourse. Our Lord is speaking about to the Jews and the Gentiles about end times. Chapter 24 speaks to the Jews about the tribulation. Chapter 25 speaks about the judgment that is how Gentiles will be judged. But he gives some parables in that passage. And in verse 21 through 25, or 23, I should say, he says, "His master said to him, 'Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things.
I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the, and watch this, the joy of your master. Also, the one who had received the 2 talents came up and said, Master, you entrusted 2 talents to me. See, I have gained 2 more talents. And his master said to him, well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of the many things. Enter into the joy of your master. Now, this is not talking about the judgment seat of Christ. What's left at this point is that of the millennium. So he's talking about what's going to come in the millennium, how the believer is going to be rewarded. Notice that he says, and you say, how do you know that? We'll go back to 1 Peter. He says, at the revelation of Jesus Christ. The word revelation is the word for which we get the word apocalypse. That word is reserved for its use only with the second coming of Christ. So clearly it's talking about the second coming of Christ. So I've said before, we often think about just the judgment seat of Christ, that the believer is going to be held accountable for his life, or his, some people say, works. I think it's the sum total of one's life. But there is also a reward awaiting each of us in the millennium, determining how we will serve in the millennium. We're not going to sit around, floating on clouds during the millennium. Yes, we'll have glorified bodies. But now let's move on in verse 8. Back in verse 8, he says, and though you have not seen, you love him, and though you do not see him now, but believe in him, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible, full of glory. First thing you note here is that these people had not seen Jesus. But nonetheless, they loved him, they believed in him, even though they had not seen. That faith is commendable. Sometimes we forget, in all our knowledge of the Word of God, sometimes we forget that without faith, it is impossible to please God. The account of Thomas, the disciples, apostles, all came back proclaiming he is risen. Jesus is risen. He's no longer in the grave, and Thomas wasn't with them. And Thomas, when they came back and told Thomas, and in the Greek it is, Thomas, he's risen, he's risen, he's risen, over and over. And Thomas said, no way. Unless I see his hand and touch him, I won't believe. And the Greek there is, I will know, never believe, double negative, no way. And Jesus said to Thomas, he said, okay, we'll let you have your way, touch me. But he said to Thomas, Thomas, you believe because you've seen me. More blessed are those who believe who have not seen me. Here's the third. We can have joy in suffering, knowing of God's promised fellowship. Think of Revelation 3:20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock, and if anyone hears my voice and opens up, I will come in and I will sup with him, as the King James. The literal Greek is, I will have a banquet with him. Think about that. Think about that. The God who created this universe, and you need to go see the Ark and see the Creation Museum. That'll give you a greater appreciation. This God who created this universe says, I knock on your door every day. I want to have fellowship with you. Is that not reason for joy every day? Why don't we do that? Because the propensity of man, the propensity of myself, is that our gratitude doesn't last very long, right? What happens? Our gratitude usually lasts about from 1 hour to 24 hours, right? Or from 1 month to 3 months. There's someone, I forgot his name, the guy in the financial world who said that money is the great, it's the thing that causes discontent, and it never causes contentment. That's what he basically says. And his point is that when you don't have enough money, you complain about, I'm not making enough money, and you gripe and complain. But then when you get a raise or you get promoted and you get more money than you ever thought you might have, he says before long, your baseline changes. And then you start complaining about your office or the lunchroom or the Coke machine or whatever else it might be. Here's a fourth. We can rejoice in suffering and hardship, knowing of God's promised deliverance. Our promised deliverance. I want you to go back. And by the way, the word salvation it comes from the root sozo, which means deliverance. So when we say someone has been saved from a house on fire, we mean they've been delivered, right? Look back in at this and go back to verse 4. He says, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable, undefiled, will not fade away. Now watch, reserved in heaven for you. Look in verse 5. Have a salvation ready to be revealed in the what? Last time. Look at verse 7. Again, glory and honor and praise at the revelation, the apocalypse of Jesus Christ. Now look at verse 9. Obtaining an outcome of your faith, the salvation, the deliverance of your soul. He's referring to the future. In all of these passages, he's talking about an ultimate salvation, an ultimate deliverance. We are saved at the moment that we trust Christ. There's no doubt about that. But Peter tells us that we have an inheritance that's future in eternity. I've said before, the Christian life, really, salvation is in three phases. The first phase is what we call justification. We have that, Diane? Okay. Justification. Justification is being free from the penalty of sin. The next is sanctification. That's an ongoing process where God is setting us free from the power of sin. But then there's also glorification, in which God sets us free from the presence of sin. And awaiting for us is eternity. Now think about that. This is not all there is. There is much to come. This is just a small window. That's reason to rejoice. Again, life can be tough, but you can rejoice knowing that God's going to do a work in your life, and he's not going to turn the furnace up any longer or keep you in the furnace until he knows the right time to pull you out. He will deliver us, though, eventually from this life into eternity. Now, in terms of application, a couple things. Beware of the moment, or beware of the monster of entitlement. Now, we don't think of entitlement. We think more of that other generations. We say they're entitled. But when we take God for granted, when we take these truths for granted, is that not what we think? I mean, do we not think, well, God, why aren't you? Have you ever found yourself getting angry with God because he didn't answer a prayer? And you stop and like, wait a minute. That's a sense of entitlement. God, you want a relationship with me? I mean, think of someone, again, someone great and famous that some people will ask you, who would you like to talk to for one moment? And some will say Abraham Lincoln, some will say a lot. But what? But God says the Creator wants to talk to you today. The Creator of this universe. How about that one? Number two, realize that God is calling you to his service even through suffering. Why does God leave us here on this earth? I mean, couldn't he just, I read this devotion by Spurgeon. He says, God could just take us out of this, out of here, take us directly to heaven. Why would he not? He's a good God. He wants to give us his pleasures. We just read that. Why would he not want to do that? Why would he keep us in the furnace? Because he wants us to have an impact in this world for him. Even when we're suffering. Even when we're suffering. If you've never trusted Christ, you're watching online, you're here today, it all begins with understanding who Christ is, accepting what he has done for you on the cross. He said, I've died for you. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. I am the living bread, the living water. It begins there. If you've never trusted him, say, Lord Jesus, I recognize that you've died for my sins, that I'm a sinner, that I've missed your mark, I've messed up. And all I can say is, God, I surrender. I accept what you've done, Christ, accept what you've done for me on the cross. Come into my life. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for your great word, the power of your word in our lives. Lord, we confess that we're rebels at heart. We're ungrateful, often unappreciative of what you've done for us. But thank you for forgiving us of that. And Lord, I pray that you might renew our joy at this time, that we might, for those who are struggling with where they are at this moment, I pray that you'd give them a new focus, a refocus of right thinking that leads to joyful living. And may you be glorified through our lives. We pray this in your son's name. Amen.
No other name on earth.